My name is Antonio Lazcano. I'm a Mexican professor of Origins of Life at the National University of Mexico, and I'm a member of the Colegio Nacional.
And what do you do?
Well, I'm very much involved in trying to understand how life appeared on Earth and its early evolution. So I have been engaged in experiments trying to simulate the primitive environment and analysis of meteorites, and mostly nowadays what I do is analysis of sequences of full genomes that are available in the web, so I can try to have a good understanding as far as possible of the early evolution of metabolic pathways, of the early evolution of the biological traits by making comparisons. And I'm also very keen on the history of the ideas of the origins of life, because I think it's a fascinating subject.
Okay, and are we alone?
I think so. I'm sure that we are in the solar system. I think we have always been alone. I don't think that life appears in other parts of the solar system, regardless of what many of my colleagues say. And I think that although life may not be so rare in the universe, I don't think that life with animals and primates and thinking and societies like us are very common. I think there are probably many other ways in which life can appear and evolve in the universe, but like us, I think we are basically alone.
So the many other ways, do you mean mostly microbial?
If you ask me, let me answer the way that Ernest Haeckel said in the 19th century when he was making comments on Camille Flammarion's book on the plurality des mondes habités. I think that, yeah, microbial life may exist in other parts of the galaxy, in other parts of the universe, but things like us, I think, are quite rare.
And why do you think that?
Well, if you look at the evolution of life on Earth, clearly the animals represent a truly minor component of the huge diversity of life that existed, even if we are very obvious because of our size and so on. But the history of animals and the history of primates is the outcome of so many incidents, geological incidents and mutations and chance events, that I think that it's very rare that history will repeat in the same way in other parts of the universe. That doesn't mean that there are not different ways in which matter could organize itself, but I don't think that animals like us are very frequent.
I agree with you, but couldn't you then extend your argument to microbes? There are many, the microbes on Earth are a very special kind of microbes, and so what kind of microbes would we expect elsewhere? Viruses, for example, or an RNA world, or what type of,
Well, viruses are an outcome of cells. So if you want to have life, I would not be surprised to see that there are many ways in which genetic material can be semi-independent, as is in the case of viruses, but the same is true of other things like plasmids and so on. So perhaps, yeah, you can have those things elsewhere if you have cells that can actually multiply and are based on genetic material or something equivalent like that, and a number of other molecules that are involved in metabolic pathways and structure.
Now, you said that life like that would be probably elsewhere, but you then also said that probably not on Mars. Now, why don't you think that type of life could be alive on Mars now?
I think that there is a tremendous amount of hype about Mars. I think that the people think I believe that the people think that Mars was very much like the Earth at the earliest stages of the history of the solar system. That is not proven. That's a hypothesis that not all planetologists share. And even so, remember that we really do not know how life appeared on Earth, and we will never know how life appeared on Earth. The records are bygone, so we really have no idea. But I think that even if we assume that that life, which I think is a very good assumption, that life is the natural outcome of a process of evolution, we really do not know what role was played by chance, by the chance impact of a comet, by the presence of the moon, by the presence of tides and so on. So who knows if those things also happen on Mars. I think they make up for a very nice storyline, but I don't think that's very scientific to say that life did appear on Mars and that it very likely is still there.
I'm a little bit confused because when I asked you, are we alone? You said we probably are. And then you also added to that, oh, there's probably microbial life elsewhere.
Uh-huh.
Well, so those views are, they conflict, don't they?
No, because I think it depends on how you define loneliness. You can define loneliness by being the single person on a hill, or you can actually define being with a number of microbial plant, fungi, protist companions. And in that sense, I think that if the question of loneliness is defined in terms of other intelligent beings, I think it's very unlikely that we see our equivalents in, at least in our vicinity in the galaxy. But I think that, yeah, perhaps there is something like microbial life elsewhere. Remember what Haldane once said, that the universe is not only strange, but it's even stranger than we can imagine. So I would not be surprised to see other forms of organization of matter.
But in terms of your own views and your own feelings, if we found, let's say, microbes on a planet around Proxima Centauri, would you then say we're still alone because they cannot talk and cannot exchange, you know, important ideas with us?
Well, we have communication with our microbes in many different ways. I mean, remember that we depend very strongly on the microbiome. We depend very strongly on the chemicals that are released by microbes living in our guts. We depend very strongly on the, that's part of the immunological system, on the way we relate to other life forms on Earth. Mm-hmm. And but yeah, we will be basically alone because first of all, I'm not quite sure that Proxima Centauri is a good candidate. And secondly, I really don't think that it's very obvious that you will find things like microbes there.
So you think the most important thing then would be to find other human-like intelligent life, but you think that that doesn't exist?
I think it's very unlikely that that it exists. Huh. Okay. I know it's a very pessimistic view, but I hate to be pessimistic about it, but
no,
I think that's
really optimistic. That means no one's going to come kill us.
Oh, I've never been afraid of those things. I'm more afraid of some natural disaster or some crazy act of terrorism.
Okay. Is the question, are we alone, an important question?
I think it's a very important philosophical and scientific question. And I think that efforts should be done individually and as a society to try to address those questions. That doesn't mean that I agree with the way the question is being answered by a number of my colleagues. For instance, I'm very much against it, highly anthropocentric, teleological idea that the evolution of life, if it appears, can lead to exactly to the same life forms that we see on Earth. But I think they are very, very valid questions.
Now, there seems to be a dichotomy in the field of astrobiology between the physicists who think, well, once you have life, you have technological life and human-like intelligence, and the biologists who say, well, it's more likely to have microbial life, but after that, who knows? Now, you're a biologist, so you belong to the second camp.
Clearly. But yeah. I don't belong to the astrobiological community. I don't define myself as an astrobiologist. I think that astrobiology is a wonderful funding program, but I don't think it's a new science, so I don't see how I should define myself as an astrobiologist.
So
I'm an evolutionary biologist.
You're an evolutionary biologist, yeah, who's concerned with the origin of evolution.
Absolutely.
I see. And what fraction of evolutionary biologists are concerned with the origin of life?
Oh, I will say that a significant number. Uh-huh. I think that since the 1940s, origins of life became recognized as part of the evolutionary biology framework. In the 1940s, the first chairs in origins of life were created, the first journals were created, the first societies, and very soon it was very natural for the people to incorporate the thinking about the origins of life. You actually see it, there's a wonderful coincidence about this time and the Miller experiment in 1953, which really led many people to accept the idea that life had a natural origin and that it was worth exploring it in academic institutions.
Now, you said that are we alone is an important question. Do you think it's so important that every scientist should be interested in it? Or in other words, your life has meaning because you're looking into this question?
No, not at all. I respect scientists who are concerned about how cancer develops, and I respect mathematicians that are concerned about the way topology defines a certain classes of space and so on. No, I don't think I don't think that everybody is concerned about the origin and evolution of life on Earth or elsewhere. But I think it's a very valid scientific question.
Well, some astrobiologists would argue that astrobiology is a search for, a complete or a more complete scientific genesis story, almost to replace the genesis stories.
I hate you using the word genesis. Okay. I think it has right away a number of religious implications. I prefer to use the word origin or emergence of life.
Okay, but whatever it is, it's a story, it's a scientific story, and somehow it can replace traditional origin stories, or do you disagree with that?
No, I don't think that science is designed to replace mystical or religious perspectives. I think that science should be very secular, and the nature of the question it addresses may have been influenced at some point by religion as part of the culture, but I think that the interaction is truly zero. I remember that evolutionary biology wasn't born to prove that religion is right or wrong. It's completely independent.
So you subscribe to NOMA, the non-overlapping magisteria article, like Stephen Jay Gould has written about?
In part, yes.
And in what part, no?
Well, I have no problems acknowledging that, for instance, the sense of time, the linear sense of time that we have in the West, mostly, is the outcome or was influenced by the mythology of monotheistic religions. Clearly, the idea that you have an origin and an end, which implies that time has a direction, is clearly derived from the idea that the universe appears and will eventually end. Now, if you say that in a temple, whatever its denomination, the people will say, yeah, okay, that's part of whatever religious book, teaching, and so on. But I recognizing that doesn't weaken the secular perspective. I think it just explains part of its origin, and that's it.
So you're telling me that the object, you're challenging the objectivity of the Big Bang as a starting point for time and the second law of thermodynamics as the arrow of a linear arrow of time?
No, what I'm saying is that in the 19th century, we had a little bit before, we had a major change culturally in our perception of the universe with the development of an evolutionary perspective. Remember that prior to the Enlightenment, what the people had in mind about the universe was sort of a mechanical issue, the outcome of Newton's ideas, in which the universe was sort of a clock that was running very smoothly, and you could have some issues with the planets or the satellites or the comets, but then where the angels came and adjusted everything. What I think is fascinating about the Enlightenment is that the universe is no longer a clockwork mechanism, but it also is something that changes, that has an origin, that evolves. And you see that thinking developing, for instance, in the languages, the people that spoke about the evolution of language. You have it with Kant, who spoke about the origin of the solar system together with Marquis de Laplace. You have it with Lamarck, who spoke about the evolution of living entities. You have it with Marx and Engels, who spoke about the evolution of the of production and hence the social changes. So I think if one wants to understand the origin of evolutionary biology as the defining framework of life sciences today, one has to recognize that Darwin epitomizes this evolutionary thought. Influenced by religion and art and so on, absolutely, but completely independent in the sense that I even refrain from using the religious metaphors.
Some people think that as life evolves, it gets more complex. What is your take on that issue?
Well, it depends how you define complexity. I remember that Stanley Miller used to say, quoting or paraphrasing Shakespeare, complexity is in the eyes of the beholder. You could say that a virus is a very simple entity, but behind that simplicity, you have an extraordinary evolutionary history. Let me put you an example. You can quote, for instance, Lord Byron, and you can see the poetry, which is very elaborate, or you can think of a Japanese haiku, which are very simple poets, forms of poetry. Which one is more refined? Well, it's a question that makes no sense because they simply follow different paths in the evolution of poetical expression. So I think that one should be very careful with the idea of complexity as a trait that necessarily evolves as a precondition for life changing. For instance, in the case of human, we have tissue development. Animals develop tissues, and you have tissue differentiation. And in one particular line, which is a primate line, you can have very complex brains. Well, that is not necessarily more complicated than the extraordinary complexity, if you wish, of the microbial pathways that you see in bacteria, and the very different ways in which genetic information is changed via lateral gene transfer and so on.
There's an idea about the great chain of being, and in modern biological literature, people talk about the major transitions in life. Zath Marie and Smith, John Maynard Smith, have written a book about that, and other philosophers of biology have thought about this. What is your take on what is sometimes called the major transition?
I think it's a very teleological perspective. I knew Maynard Smith. I met with him a couple of times, three or four times actually. I know Eos Hetzatmari quite well. I haven't seen him for some time. But one thing that I don't like about the book is that the way the idea is presented, it leads in an avoidable way to humans as the pinnacle of biological evolution. I disagree with that completely. Because, for instance, one issue that is not mentioned in those major transitions is the change from an oxygen poor to an oxygen rich kind of atmosphere. And the changes that it implied were absolutely quite extraordinary. It doesn't address the issue of the very high diversity of microbial metabolisms. So I think in many ways it was teleologically oriented. It's a very valuable book. It's written in a beautiful style. The English that Maynard Smith had was fantastic. I think it was Queen's English or King's English. But the basic idea is too teleological for me. A number of people have actually addressed that issue.
Would you say that there are major transitions in life, but it depends on which lineage you're talking about, that every lineage has its own major transition?
You could say it, but then you can also say that I think that one of them, apart from the origins of life, I think that one major event that took place on the history of life on Earth was the appearance of eukaryotic cells due to endosymbiotic events, as detailed and forcefully argued by Lynn Margulis. And then I think it's equally important to recognize the role of the biosphere as a very powerful biogeochemical agent, life as a geological force, if you wish. And then, for instance, think about the fungi. Fungi are rarely discussed by the people that are concerned about extraterrestrial life, but in fact, fungi are the sister group of animals. In fungi, you never see real tissues. In animals, you do. So what happened during the divergence of fungi and animals that led, in one case, to organisms that are very sophisticated, have very complex sexual lives, have very complex ecology, and in the case of animals, that we went the other direction.
Could it be the loss of the cell wall?
Loss
of cell wall?
Well, that will be only part of the problem. I think that the really issue is why do we develop in one case tissues and in other ones not? I mean, One trait that epitomizes in the eyes of many the traits of animals is the characteristics of animals is precisely tissues. And with tissues, eventually you will have brains and bones and blood and so on. Well, that doesn't make us more complicated or less complicated than a population of different bacteria interacting among themselves.
What do we know about the origin of life?
Well, I think that we know that it was a natural outcome of an evolutionary process. I think that most of us, not all, will agree that there was a very efficient synthesis of organic compounds prior to the emergence of life. I think it's fairly established that it appears soon after the Earth was formed. So in that sense, it was a geochemical event linked to the conditions of the primitive Earth. And I think that we know that a basic trait for life to appear had to involve evolvability. In other words, I think that you can have a very complex chemical melange on the primordial Earth, but it depends, its evolvability will depend on something that would have the ability to multiply with divergence and therefore be able to the vagaries of natural selection. And for me, the current best candidate is RNA, although I agree with many of my friends that it was probably preceded by something else.
Do you have any idea what that it would be?
Well, some people argue for RNA-like molecules, which it's something that I tend to like, the idea that you had different backbones instead of the phosphodiester backbone that we see in RNA and in DNA today. I think that it's reasonable to assume that there were different sugars. I think that it's reasonable to assume that the diversity of nitrogen bases was different. But the basic idea that you have genetic polymers, they are complementary and separate and hence can multiply and diverge, I think it's a very essential idea.
Do you have any idea about the order in which the components of what we now call life evolved?
Well, if you look at meteorites, which are samples of the chemistry that was taking place during the times in which life may have appeared on Earth, you see both amino acids and nitrogen bases and phosphonic acids and sulfonic acids and lipids that can form membranes. So I think that the question is really how do you get something that resembles a cell and can evolve out of that very complex melange of things. Sometimes, let me put it this way. Some people speak about the RNA world, the protein world, the lipid world. I'm against a plurality of worlds.
You're for a plurality of worlds.
No, I don't see why we should have all those different things. I think that they were basically synthesized and available at the same time.
So coevolution of those.
Coevolution, yeah, if you want to call it. But don't think of coevolution in Darwinian terms as in symbiosis. No, I will say prebiotic coevolution of systems.
Prebiotic coevolution of systems.
Yeah.
What do you think of Woese's views, particularly the concept of a Darwinian threshold?
Oh, I don't think it makes any sense.
Why not?
I think that that had to do with the reconstruction of the last universal common ancestor, of the last common ancestor, that is really simply a statistical reconstruction based on the trace of the different lineages that we see today. They are shared among all living entities, and from there you try to have an idea of what was their ancestor. But one has to take into account the very complex history of gain and losses from traits, and therefore you don't need to advocate many genes in pieces that are coding for different things. It reminds me of Empedocles, the Greek philosopher, who said that, yeah, in the primitive world you had arms and hands and ears and eyes, and they somehow come together. That's not the way evolution worked. Plus, something that's very important is that if you assume that you had all these piecemeal components, and how come they have the same genetic code? How come you can take one gene or a sequence from one bacteria and put it into a different one? Well, because we share the same code, so clearly, prior to that complex mixture that Woese was advocating, you still need a primordial population that already sharing the same genetic code and the same traits of gene expression and genome replication.
You mentioned earlier about the possibility of finding microbial type life elsewhere. If we do find that, what is your best guess about what type of chemistry we will share with them?
I think most people will agree that we'll have the same carbon-based chemistry, but other than that, I wouldn't be...
Water as well?
Well, most likely, yes. Water is very abundant in the universe. There's a book that few people have read, unfortunately, called The Fitness of the Environment, published by Henderson in 1917, the first edition. And it's fantastic because he goes through the properties of water, of the elements, and so on, and comes up with very solid conclusions about why. Sounds a little bit Panglossian, it's like the best possible universe we could have, but it's presents good set of arguments for assuming the same kind of chemistry. And then there are those famous papers by George Wall, published, one of them in 1957, I think, in Scientific American, and then in a book edited by Bernard Pullman, also on the idea of why we are made of what we are made of. I think those are solid arguments. But when you do the inventory of the elements, people normally think that we are made of carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, and phosphorus. They tend to forget metals, and metals are absolutely essential for the functioning of a living entity, as we know.
What are the most important metals?
Well, if you want to have polymerases, which are the enzymes that will help replicate, they're essential in the replication of genetic material, you need zinc. Magnesium and manganese are clearly essential. Cobalt is a component of vitamin B12, which is a cofactor of requiring the biosynthesis of the oxyribonucleotides. Iron is essential as an oxygen carrier, think of hemoglobin, but also in ways of protecting against oxygen, detecting and carrying oxygen.
If I could just eliminate all manganese, would that kill all of life on Earth?
I think that some organisms will have a hard time not having manganese around.
Some, but not all.
Not all, sure. But again, when you think of life on the Earth, think of that very complex network of in which communities are sharing gases, food sources, vitamins, and so on. So perhaps if you destabilize that kind of very complex ecosystem today by doing away with a given species, perhaps then the whole thing collapses, perhaps.
So you're not into the experiment of removing these important metals one by one to see which is the most important and which is
I don't think it's very important to say which is the key one. I think that's it's a set of molecules, a set of elements, a set of metals that are essential for life as we know it today.
And do you think that's been the case from the very beginning? You don't think that life started out with one or two metals and then, oh, I can use this one, oh, I can use this one. Oh,
I think there was a selection of metals. I do think there was a selection of metals. Things, for instance, on coenzymes, they are comparable to, let us say, to tetrapyrroles, like cytochrome and so on. Some of them depend on iron, some of them depend on magnesium, think of chlorophyll, some of them depend on cobalt, think of vitamin B12, but we have one particular case, which is one known case, which is an archaea methanogenic prokaryote that actually has nickel, which is very unusual. So, well, how key is the role played by that microorganisms in today's ecological systems, we really don't know, but it's certainly essential in some of them.
Now, some astrobiologists, and in particular Simon Conway Morris, have the following logic. They say, if we can identify things in life on Earth that have evolved independently multiple times, then these aspects of life become good candidates for what we should expect elsewhere. Do you agree with that logic?
Well, first of all, I'm not quite sure that he will agree with calling himself an astrobiologist. I'm not quite sure he will
evolutionary
agree.
Biologist. Okay.
But evolutionary biologist, yes, paleontologist. Well, it's an approach, but I think there are other approaches that you could be based on the abundance of the elements, on the key role they may play or not in key biological processes and so on. I'm not aware of any single polymerase that can do without zinc. And I will argue that perhaps we actually see it. It's not necessary for me to make up a story. I mean, we do see some polymerases that have a different architecture, clearly originated independently, but nevertheless they have zinc. So there you have a case of convergence towards the same binding of the metal that is key for transition
states. How do you know it's convergence rather than a common origin?
In some cases, no. I mean, living entities have invented independently some traits several times, and I can give you some examples. Lysine, for instance, is a very important amino acid, and we know at least three different ways of synthesizing lysine that have appeared in different biological groups.
And they're not related to each other?
They're not related to each other
But they're all related. They have to have common ancestors, so they're related to each
other. Yeah, so they are latent inventions, which is something that we recognize quite easily as a process of adaptation went by.
Okay. And now Simon Conway Morris also suggests that we should expect hominids elsewhere, and his argument is based on some, he thinks that there are selection pressures which are common and therefore they will move, they will select in similar ways no matter where you are and therefore end up in similar products that we have on Earth, like hominids or animals or fungi or plants. And you disagree with those arguments?
Well, I think it's a far cry from what we know to extrapolate to other environments of which we know nothing about.
Well, he thinks convergence, multiple instances of convergence, as you just suggested, are the evidence for those types of valleys of...
Yeah, but again, it's based on what we know of terrestrial life. And unless we know something of extraterrestrial life, and we are not even sure that there is extraterrestrial life, I wouldn't be willing to buy that argument. And in fact, it's an argument that was put forward a long time before by Jacques Monod in his Chance and Necessity in a very elegant way.
I noticed, now let's talk about phylogenetic trees. I noticed in the phylogenetic tree you showed today in your talk that you had lots and lots of unresolved branching order. It's kind of like, I think Norm Pace has done work like that. They said, we should stop pretending we can get the branching order, therefore everything comes out at, like a big fan. Mm-hmm. Other people say, no, the branching order here, then this, then this, then this. What is your take on phylogenetic trees and their importance in trying to understand the evolution of life, the origin of life, and potentially life elsewhere?
Well, one shouldn't forget that a phylogenetic tree is a hypothesis on how life evolved. It's a hypothesis on how the group that under consideration actually evolved. And your hypothesis may be wrong, and one has to be very careful in acknowledging those wrong aspects of our model. And in some cases, you can have phylogenies based on anatomy, you can have phylogenies based on molecules, you can have phylogenies based on the mathematical comparison of sequences, which was the idea put forward in the 1960s by Emile Zucker-Candle, who was a very dear friend of mine, and Linus Pauling, whom I met only twice and spoke very briefly with him. But the idea is essential that you have a highly reductionist, explicitly acknowledged as a highly reductionist way of just using one single trait to construct a tree. Now, if you do that, you come out, for instance, with eukaryotes as being separated, the nucleocytoplasm being separated from mitochondria and chloroplast. Does that make sense in terms of what you actually see with living entities? No, but it's a highly reductionist way of depicting the past history of the biosphere that we see today. In some cases, because the sequences belong to rapidly evolving biological entities, we may be unable to see the divergence order, the way they separated one from another. In some cases, we can do a series of mathematical tricks, not making up data, but using statistical methods. They are very strong, very well defined, in order to come out with the divergence of one trait of one particular entity over the other one. But I think one should never forget that phylogenies are hypotheses of the reconstruction of a set of organisms or components of organisms, and that one should be always very eclectic. If the tree doesn't coincide with what we know of the biology, what is wrong is the tree, not the biology.
Okay. How about Stephen Jay Gould was known for doing a thought experiment about replaying the tape of life.
Yeah.
And what do you think of that?
Well, I think it was a very interesting experiment, and I think I agree with his basic conclusion.
Which is?
Well, that if you wouldn't have the same thing, let me put it differently. If the meteorite had not fallen at the end of the Cretaceous, would we be here? Most likely no. Will there be some kind of dinosaur interviewing another type kind of dinosaur? Most likely not. So I think one has to acknowledge the role of chance in evolution, which is very critical.
Okay. And What do you know about the evidence? Some people say that RNA preceded DNA. What's the evidence for that?
I think that we have very strong pieces of evidence. People will say, okay, look at the way that RNA does catalysis and DNA doesn't, unless we force the situation in the lab. But I think that the hypothesis of RNA preceding DNA is supported by a number of things. First of all, if you want to have RNA, you need ribonucleotides, and ribonucleotides are synthesized in all living entities that have the trait in the same way. So it's clearly a very ancient monophyletic trait. Then if you have ribonucleotides, if you want to have DNA, you need the oxyribonucleotides in all living entities that have the synthesis of the exoribonucleotides. These are always made from the reduction of ribonucleotides. So there you have a very clear issue that comes from the an evolutionary analysis of biochemical pathway.
So the biosynthesis of DNA
requires absolutely.
The synthesis of RNA.
Absolutely. Then think of, for instance, that you can have coding the RNA, as in a virus, as in the messenger RNA, and you can have non-coding RNA. And then when you have non-coding RNA, it can be very small, like the P with the argonauts and so on, which are involved in regulation. Or you can have RNA, non-coding RNA, as in ribosomal RNA, or transfer RNA, or the primer RNA. And then think of the key role that modified ribonucleotides play. For instance, histidine. Histidine is the most abundant amino acid in the catalytic site of enzymes, and it's a modified ribonucleotide. You need a ribonucleotide to synthesize histidine, without which you will never have catalytic activity, or very unlikely you will have catalytic activity in proteins. Or think of coenzymes, which is the hypothesis put forward in the 1970s by Harold White and independently by Leslie Orgel. Many of the coenzymes are actually ribonucleotidyl derivatives. So I think that if you look in perspective, clearly what that is telling you is that RNA came before DNA. Some people will take that further back in time and say, okay, what happened was that RNA actually came before proteins. It's a far cry, which I'm quite willing to accept, but clearly it doesn't depend on one single property of RNA. It depends on the entire key role that RNA and ribonucleotides play in extant cellular processes.
What is the what preceded RNA? What came and what is there a biosynthetic pathway that produces RNA that, if you stop it, it produces something else on the way to RNA?
Well, you need just a few amino acids, you need ammonia, you need carbonate, you need PRPP, which is a phosphorylated sugar that has just been synthesized abiotically a couple of weeks ago by a group that included Marie-Christine Morel here in France. But I'm pretty sure that RNA came after the primordial broth. That should be understood as this complex mixture of organic compounds. What happened in between, I have no idea, and I think it's an issue of a considerable debate among us working in the origins of life.
What is in your primordial broth?
Oh, what we see in meteorites. I mean, I have no problem recognizing the presence of bases of amino acids in racemic mixtures, lipid compounds that can form membranes, in some cases, phosphorus and
so
on.
Is this a soluble organic matter?
Well, it's soluble organic matter, but don't forget that when we speak about the primitive soup, we are not thinking of a bile in the lab that has just the right conditions. Don't think of a very complex geochemical system where you could have clays and minerals and metallic ions and different components and so on.
What do you think, do you have a definition of life, or what do you think of the idea of trying to define life?
Well, I think you can make an operational definition of life. Look, if you are a mathematician, you can define without any problem an imaginary number. Okay, it's the square root of a negative number, which is absolutely imaginary. If you're a lawyer, you can define a traffic infraction. Driving through the red light is an infraction. It's clearly something illegal. Life is something that you define depending on the context, historical context in which you are. 50 years ago, few textbooks included the DNA or nucleic acids in the definition of life. 80 years ago, people spoke about protoplasm, which is a term that we have basically forgotten by now. So that is telling you that our definition of life depends on how what we know in a given historical moment of life phenomenon. So I think that's for a starter. Secondly, the definitions of life normally involve a series of discussions that have to do with the preference that people have for a given molecule. And finding an abstract definition is not so easy. I think one can list traits and use them to as a philosophical or scientific argument.
Let's go back to 390 BC, and you mm-hmm. be Socrates, and I'll be Plato, and let's talk about life. How would Socrates, what would Socrates have said about definition of life? Would he be at all interested in this question?
Well, he would, but in a different sense than we are today. People tend to extrapolate to the past questions that have been defined mostly since the 19th century onwards, which I think is a mistake. I, of course, you will find people wondering about what life is, what matter is, what energy is, but I think one shouldn't take those issues out of the historical context in which they were actually seen. I think that for Plato and for Socrates, the basic issue was trying to understand fairness, justice, the good, the bad, and so on, which was perfectly logical when you think about the society that we're living in.
Weren't they interested in life versus non-life?
Well, not them. The one who was really interested was Aristotle. Remember that Aristotle, who was a student of Plato, had a very strong interest in natural sciences. The story is told many times that Alexander the Great, who was his student, as he went towards India, would send him samples of animals and plants for Plato to study, who was quite an extraordinary.
Aristotle to study.
Yeah. But I don't think he was truly concerned about the definition of life as we see it today. That is a very modern question.
How old is that question?
I think it basically comes with the Enlightenment.
Absolutely.
Because you see La Mettrie, the machine man, wondering of how you can make a mechanical analog to a man and wondering about conscience. And then you see the arguments between him and other members of the encyclopedia arguing against that, and I think it's basically a late 18th century question, 19th century.
Now, recently, Yuri Milner gave $100 million to Project Listen to increase the sensitivity of the SETI mm-hmm. search. What do you think of that?
I think it's wonderful. I think that is some. We should look for life elsewhere, but I don't think that it should be. I think it's a question that has been to address critically, but I'm delighted that people have the money.
If I gave you $100 billion with the caveat you have to spend it to try to answer the question, are we alone, how would you spend it?
Oh, it's a question that makes no sense because I don't think that you have the money nor I will have the hand to wait for it.
So you don't like this hypothetical question?
No, I don't.
It's too hypothetical to
even consider. It's too hypothetical both for you to offer it and for me to receive it.
Okay. Do you have a favorite solution to Fermi's paradox?
Yeah, the solution is very simple. He was a physicist thinking in terms of abstract questions that make no sense for biologists.
Okay, so in other words, the easy solution is that human intelligence is not a convergent feature of evolution, therefore we should not expect technological civilizations elsewhere.
I think so, yeah. I think that's your solution.
It's
a good summary, but I also think that there's a strong divide. Remember that biologists can be very parochial, whereas astronomers and theoretical physicists like to make very broad generalizations. Fermi's question is a very good example of a very intelligent person who, by the way, was a professor of Stanley Miller. I'll tell you an anecdote right away about it. But I think it's typical of a physicist to ask that question. And the anecdote is fascinating because after Stanley Miller had published his paper, he was invited to give a seminar in the Department of Chemistry at the University of Chicago, where he was working with Harold Urey. And Stanley was a little bit nervous because normally only very distinguished visitors, professors, scientists gave those lectures. So he presented his work, and when he finished, the first hand that was raised and the first question that was made came from Enrico Fermi, who had, by the way, a photographic memory, and Stanley remembered that extremely well. And so Fermi asked Stanley, Stanley, do you think this is the way in which God created life? Of course, he was using a metaphor. And then very rapidly, Harold Urey got up and said, Enrico, if he didn't did it this way, he missed a big chance.
That's what Urey said. Stanley did not have the...
No, Stanley was just overwhelmed by the question. And
okay, let me ask a question of your emotional side, not your rational side, mm-hmm. but your emotional part of your brain. What kind of aliens would you like to find?
I don't care about those questions. I
mean, so it's too hypothetical again?
Yeah, again, no.
Because
no.
You have it in your head, well, wait a minute, there are different types of microbes. Some microbes you might like, prefer over others.
No, not really. No.
How about ones that are identical, have very similar biochemistry to ones that have very, very different chemistry? Wouldn't you like to find ones with
the basic biochemistry of all life on Earth is the same. There are very small differences.
No, but how about the alien biochemistry?
Would you like? I don't think that that's a question that I could answer. I don't care about that question.
So,
don't get me wrong. I do not think it's a valid question, but I think it's a question that I have no elements to answer. And
well, you were teasing physicists about the Fermi paradox as being something that comes out of physics. What is the closest equivalent to that question that comes out of biology?
No, I think the question will be, what are the deterministic and the random processes involved in the origins of life?
So that dichotomy is a good one to try to dissect whatever else. Deterministic versus random.
I think so. The proportion of the two.
So
things.
Chance and necessity, Manod.
I got it once again. Yeah.
Okay. In the question, "Are we alone?" What does the word "we" mean to you?
I think it's a reflection of how anthropocentric the issue was raised from the very beginning. For me, it's a valid scientific question, it's a valid philosophical question, but for me, it's, we don't have the elements to answer that.
But what does the word "we" mean?
Think it's very clearly, it's a very, that's what I say, anthropocentric.
So we human beings.
We human beings, yeah.
But when I ask that of people, about half the time they think "we human beings," the other half they mean "we the life on Earth."
Oh yeah, and I suppose it depends very strongly on the prejudices of the people.
Occasionally, if I ask a child that, they think "we" in this room, and they say, "No, we're not alone. There are people there. My family's over there."
Yeah. But then, I don't think that children are fun to look at, fun to talk to. But I think the question shouldn't be taken out of a context.
Okay. Have you ever seen a UFO?
No.
Have you ever been abducted by an alien?
No, not really.
How do you deal with people who you give a lecture and then they say, "Wait, I saw this UFO, there's an alien abducted me," or what do you just...
Now and then you get that kind of questions for a question from the audience, now and then. So I say, well, thank you very much for sharing your experience with that. Next question.
Okay. What do you think are the students or the public's biggest misconceptions about this question, "Are we alone?"
I think the students tend to very quickly use all the elements, intellectual elements they have to try to formulate the question in a scientific way, which I think is wonderful. I think that if the public is uneducated in science, which doesn't mean they are not educated in other fields, they probably will try to address it in terms of their personal experience, and I'm afraid that most of the times their personal experience is related to movies or to television accounts of ET and whatever.
And that's not necessarily what you think is a good idea.
Well, I think it's fun, but I don't think it leads to anywhere.
Okay. Do you have any advice for students who are thinking about becoming astrobiologists or becoming...
No, I will tell them right away, don't get engaged into astrobiology. In Mexico, we had a superb tradition, as we do in the rest of Latin America, about evolutionary biology.
Say that again, please.
In Mexico and in Latin America, we have an extraordinarily rich tradition of evolutionary biology.
Yes.
And my advice will be, go into studying evolution, choose a type of organism or a type of process or a question and try to address it from the Darwinian perspective.
Okay. Or become a chemist?
Yeah, for instance, yeah.
Okay, or an astronomer and look for exoplanets?
For instance, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay, and are we alone?
I think yes.
And why do
you? In the solar system, for sure. And I think that in the universe, perhaps there are other life forms, but I don't think that evolution, if any, has led to something remotely comparable to us. I appreciate the role of chance.
Some people would say that that's arrogant to think that we're the only human-like intelligence in the universe.
Oh, no, quite on the contrary. I think it's very arrogant to assume that things like us will emerge elsewhere.
Okay. Now, in the movie Contact, have you seen the movie Contact?
I can tell you what I went to see that movie. Okay. Because I had invited Carl Sagan to go to Mexico, and I've never been keen on science fiction. And I invited him to go to Mexico, and he said, I will, as long as you take me to visit a wonderful chapel, Santa Maria Tonantzintla, which is quite close to Puebla, a big city in Mexico City, and as long as you promise to see Contact. And I said, okay, I'll fulfill my part of the promise. He did not. He died before he could have the chance to visit Mexico. And I did go to see Contact, actually here in Paris, as a posthumous way of remembering him.
Mm-hmm. And in the movie, several times, the question is asked, are we alone? And the kind of answer that comes out is, well, if we are, it's an awful waste of space.
It's a very old issue. It actually comes from a 19th century French writer.
Who is that?
I don't recall the name now, but he says, if we are alone, what a big waste of space. If we are not alone, where are they?
So what do you think of this idea that if we are alone, which you suggest might be the case, do you think it's a waste of space?
No, I don't think, I simply think it reveals the complexity of a universe in which matter can take so many different forms in so many different ways.
So that's not a waste of space?
No, no, not at all, not at all. No. To think so will be, in fact, very anthropocentric.
And that's bad.
Well, I think it represents a bias in your understanding of nature.
But aren't all human morals anthropocentric?
No.
Don't we think our lives are more important than the mosquito that I just killed?
Well, no, that's a very old question. It comes from the 5th century by St. Augustine of Hippo. But I think that different societies have different ways of looking at ourselves. I mean, for instance, I come from a society in which community is much more important than the individuality that you see as the basic trait of, let us say, Anglo-Saxon societies like in the USA.
Mm. Arthur C. Clarke said that any sufficiently advanced technology would be indistinguishable from magic. And a guy named Carl Schroeder said, no, you're wrong. Any sufficiently advanced technology will be indistinguishable from nature. What do you think of that? Any comments?
Well, Arthur C. Clarke was a wonderful writer of science fiction, but then again, I'm not very keen on science fiction. I think he was using a rhetoric figure that's very nice.
Carl Sagan must have views that are different from yours. For example, he said that the humans are the way the universe has to becoming self-aware.
That actually comes from Hegel. Hegel said it first, yeah.
Okay, so Carl Sagan borrowed it from Hegel.
Well, perhaps unknowingly, but Hegel said it, and then Engels said it in a very dogmatic way. But
now, given the idea that you don't think human-like intelligence evolves elsewhere, you must think that that's crazy, or what do you think of that idea?
No, let me use a very parochial example, which is the case of the human brain, the flexibility of the human brain on Earth. If you look at the way we use the silver when dining, you have the fork and you have the knife. If you go to Japan or to China, the people will eat with chopsticks. That in itself is an extraordinary example of the flexibility of the human mind. The plasticity that we have that allows us just in this planet to use the brain and the intelligence to come out with completely different solutions to the same problem. Th- think of the spoon. If you look at a spoon from a Chinese spoon or a spoon in the West, they are basically the same because there's only one way in which you can make a spoon that works. So I think that is telling you a lot about the restrictions and the flexibility, the plasticity of human creativity. If that's true for the Earth, why shouldn't we assume that it's true if there's intelligent life elsewhere?
I thought you said you don't think that there's intelligent
life. I don't think the way we define intelligence, the way we define primates, the way we define our history, I don't think there is. But I mean, that's just an example of how plastic the human mind is.
Well, some people would take that exact argument and say, it's better to be smart than it is to be stupid. It's better to have a big brain and flexibility that's more adaptive than the contrary. Well, and that's the basis they use for believing that there is human-like intelligence elsewhere.
Yeah, but it's also true that you have examples of very stupid animals on Earth. They are survivors of after many million years of history of the biosphere. Think of the koala, if you want to think of a mammal, well, of an animal that's closer to us, or think of the slugs, the marine slugs that do not appear to be very intelligent by any account. I mean, and they are still there.
So, being smart. There's no such. You don't believe in an intelligence niche, then?
Oh, I think that intelligence is a wonderful trait to survive in a given lifestyle, in a given niche. But I don't think it's the only one.
Or you don't think there's a generic intelligence niche?
It depends how you define what kinds of intelligence. Again, I need to see a good definition of intelligence that acknowledges that diversity.